Okay, let's get started. We're going to conduct an EOC review to help you get ready to take the EOC test. So this presentation is going to follow the booklet that's available to download on eClass. It is a 70-page PDF document. I'm going to go in the same order in which that booklet is written. So if you want to go ahead and download that and have that handy as I begin, that would be a wise choice. All right, so the first thing the book refers to is the law of reflection. And just before we get started, let me go ahead and make sure that I say that the book, the order in which it's written, it has review questions that are spread sporadically and kind of mixed throughout the document. So you're going to see some things that don't necessarily go in order. But the first thing it did mention was a law of reflection. And what this states is that the angle of incidence and the angle of reflection should be the same. You should always see a line that is perpendicular to the reflective surface that is going to bisect the line that where you have the incident ray and the reflected ray. So this angle that is formed when it is bisected by the perpendicular line leading to the reflective surface, you should have equivalent angles. Here is a sample question, so take a second to go ahead and look at that and think about what you think the correct answer should be. For this answer, you should definitely choose B. And the reason that you should choose B is because as you see the line bisecting and hitting the reflective surface perpendicularly, that you have 45 degrees as a measurement of both the angle of incidence and reflection. The other three sample choices that you have available all have numbers that are not the same. Whereas 45 and 55 are close, it is still not equivalent. So the only answer choice that you should have chosen should be B. Next, the booklet moves into heat. Remember that heat is a transfer of thermal energy. It is not thermal energy itself, but is when that thermal energy is transferred from one object to another. We have convection. Convection is a movement of liquid or gas particles. What typically happens in convection is you're going to have a circular motion where the warmer particles are going to rise up to the top, and the cooler particles, the ones that have less thermal energy, are going to sink down below. And as this happens, it warms the entire liquid and it raises the temperature. So it's a movement of those particles as they fluctuate in that circular format that is really what defines convection. Radiation is a movement of thermal energy without the use of matter. So with radiation, no gas, no liquid, nor solid is required. Conduction is going to involve solids in most cases, and it's where a particle will transfer its energy to a neighboring particle through direct contact. The big terminology here is direct contact, because conduction always involves particles that are right next to each other that are actually touching each other. All right, so here's a sample question. It says, in a demonstration of heating by convection, your teacher heats a beaker of water to boiling on a hot plate. Which hypothesis correctly describes how heating by convection occurs? So take a moment to look at the sample question and the choices and attempt to answer this on your own. So here the correct answer choice should definitely be A. And this says, as particles of a substance are heated, energy is transferred as more energetic particles within the substance move from one place to another. So as this is occurring, what we have going on is a movement of those particles. And they're moving around from place to place, and they're transferring that energy to nearby particles. Okay? You might have chosen B. And yeah, there are some collisions that might be taking place, but that typically happens more in a gas. But at the same time, if this is actually occurring, it's not the collisions themselves that are transferring the energy. It is just being close to those particles that's doing that. This one mentions gas bubbles. Again, those gas bubbles, that's just part of the process of evaporation. So the liquid is becoming the gas. So your correct answer would not be C. And for D, this does not involve electromagnetic waves at all. So the best answer choice here is definitely going to be A. Take a moment to read and try to answer the next question. Okay, so in this sample question, what you must do first is you must find the density of the object that is listed right here. So this says that it has a mass of 10 and a volume of 8. So you're going to divide 10 over 8, and I believe that gives you 1.25. You're going to take that number that you have and compare it to the density of these liquids. Now, remember, when you talk about buoyancy, what enables something to be buoyant is if the density of the object is less than the density of the liquid, it will float. If it is greater, it will sink. So here, if I have 1.25 as my density of my object, you can see that it will not float in these two liquids. It will actually sink down to the bottom because the density of the cube is higher. This would be like if you place a piece of metal in a glass of water, it's going to sink down. Whereas right here, we have 1.3 and 1.4, so it will definitely float in those two. So your correct answer choice you should have chosen here is B. Remember that density is mass over volume. We can use grams and cubic centimeters for our units for those two measurements. Remember that we could also list milliliters here, and 1 milliliter is equivalent to a cubic centimeter. All right, so this next slide, this mentions velocity and it mentions acceleration. A couple of things about this. There are some terms that are listed in the phrase in the text you see right here. It talks about forces. A force can cause a change in motion. Balance forces means that there will be no acceleration, and an unbalanced force is going to result in acceleration. Now, the terms that are used right here, it says unbalanced forces change the motion of an object. Well, if you change the motion of an object in any way, that is acceleration. So acceleration can happen in three ways. First of all, the object can become faster. Secondly, it can become slower. And third, it can just change direction. So any of those changes in motion is going to be something that we define as being acceleration. So it's a change in velocity. Change in velocity means it's a change in speed or direction, because speed and direction constitute velocity. So our formula for velocity, or average velocity, is the change in distance divided by the change in time. I like to say delta D over delta T. The book says final minus initial distance and final time minus initial time. On the other hand, acceleration is going to be defined as the change of velocity over change in time, delta V over delta T, or as it's written right here, final velocity minus initial velocity divided by final time minus initial time. So we have a sample question. Which hypothesis describes the behavior of molecules when a substance changes from a gas to a liquid? So take a moment to read your choices and try to answer the question to the best of your ability, and then we'll talk about it. All right, so the first thing I want to say is this. When we change from a gas to a liquid, we're moving from a higher state of energy to a lower state. Remember that solids, even though those particles are still moving and vibrating, in a solid we have the lowest energy state available. Plasma is the highest. So it goes in the order of solid, liquid, gas, plasma. in this sample question, we need to be under we need to understand that if I go from a gas to a liquid, I'm moving to a lower energy state. So what's going to happen to my particles is they're going to slow down a little bit. So a couple of things we can do right now is we know that the average speed of those molecules, we know that's decreasing. So we can go ahead and eliminate A and D as potential answer choices because it says increases. It says the speed of the molecules increases. So we know it's not A or D. Let's look at the dependent clause here in this sentence. It says the average speed of the molecules decreases because they have a lower energy in the liquid state. That is true. So here you should choose B for your answer because it tells you what's happening and why. Now, C is very close, but it says they have a higher energy, and that is not true. So the answer choice that you should have here is B. Another sample question. It takes a person 1/2 hour to run 6 kilometers at a constant rate along a straight line path. What is the velocity of the person? So here, let me just kind of free up some space to write. In this sample question, what we have going on is you need to remember the formula that was illustrated in the previous slide. So, remember that velocity is going to be change in distance over change in time. And if we look up here, everything is illustrated in kilometers per hour. All right, so looking at the data or the sentence that we're asked, she or it's a person, they run 6 kilometers. So the change in distance is gonna be 6 kilometers. Put my 6 there. And then it says that this takes place in 1/2 hour. Now, if I want to put that down numerically, I should write it as 0.5 hours. All right. Before I do the math and I simplify this, I want to go ahead and talk about that straight line path part because that is very important. If you look, you know, when you run a race, if you run a straight line, that's actually pretty rare. There's many times when people go out to run a race and they'll have some curves and they'll go around and, you know, it will not be straight. Now, the idea is this. If I measure from here to here, that's going to be shorter than the entire length in which they run. All right, so to avoid that confusion, the question it actually just states for you in the wording that is a straight line path. All right, so we can go ahead and not have to worry about this curvature and the total length and things like that. Let's just, you know, focus on that straight line. So to solve this, you're going to have your unit, and again, speed is a rate, so it involves a quantity and a time period. 6 divided by 0.5 is going to give you 12. So your answer choice for this question should be D, 12 kilometers per hour in the direction of the path. That brings us to the next question. Now this one also involves velocity, but what we have going on is we have what looks to be a free fall. So we have a marble, and that marble is falling to the ground. All right, and the question is, small marble is dropped to the floor, it's the floor, not the ground, so no tree. Assume that as a marble falls, the only force exerted on it is a force of gravity. How did the speed and acceleration of the marble change with time? All right, so we need to ask ourselves what's happening to this marble. We know that gravity is operating on that marble. Remember that gravity has a constant acceleration at 9.8 meters per second squared. So, what effect is that going to have on the speed? First of all, let's remember that typically in a situation where you have a falling object, you're going to have gravity, and you're going to have some air resistance, and you might have something else happening too. But the question tells us to assume that the only force operating on this is gravity. So we can isolate everything else. It's just gravity we're worrying about here. Gravity is the only force operating on it, no air friction. So what's going to happen? Well, it's going to accelerate because of that gravity. That's going to cause the speed to increase. So we know that the answer is going to be A or C because it says speed increases. What about acceleration? Well, here this says acceleration increases. Well, that's not how gravity works. Gravity is a constant acceleration. So the 9.8, that does not change. That's just what the acceleration is. So the best answer choice here is going to be C, because acceleration is going to cause the velocity to increase, but there's nothing that's going to happen to this acceleration. It's going to remain what it is. So acceleration remains constant. Your answer choice that you should choose here is C, because gravity does not fluctuate. It remains it's a constant variable. It's a constant acceleration. Speed is going to increase because of the acceleration. All right, let's look at the next question. Go ahead and read it and try to answer it on your own. This is talking about motion. All right, so let's look at this question. We're trying to see which one demonstrates the law of motion, Newton's first law. That is sometimes referred to as the law of inertia, or inertia, just plain inertia. So our answer choices are: an astronaut does not weighs more on Earth than he does on the Moon, but his mass does not change. Okay, that's going to be more reminiscent of the second law of motion, which is F equals ma. A baseball thrown by a professional player has a greater acceleration than a baseball you throw. Again, I think that's F equals MA. The mass of the baseball is the same, but that professional player is going to be able to have more force. C, a book placed beside you in the backseat of a car slices the floor as a car stops suddenly. Well, that sounds to me like inertia. As that car stops, the book wants to keep moving, and that's what causes it to slide to the floor. And again, D, again, to me sounds like F equals MA, because it talks about a stone versus a stone with more mass, and that would be F equals MA. The more mass it has, the more force it's going to have behind it. So the correct answer choice here is C. All right, moving into energy now. Just understand that there are some different sources of energy. Fossil fuels, geothermal, hydroelectric, nuclear, solar, and wind. But each of those can become these types of energy. And we have chemical energy, electrical, electromagnetic, mechanical, nuclear, radiant or light energy, sound energy, and thermal energy. Remember that when energy travels, it travels in waves. And as a wave moves, it's not particles of matter that are transferred, but it's the energy itself. And sometimes it just uses energy to, uses matter to transfer that energy. So looking at what we have here, let's move on to the statement regarding specific heat capacity. So looking at thermal energy, this is probably one of the most challenging things we've looked at this year. And that is our Q equals MC delta T formula, or the specific heat capacity formula. All right, so, you know, there's a text here that's kind of explaining what the formula means, but I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to explain it myself in a different way. All right, so when we look at that formula, even though it looks a little strange, it really is not very complicated at all. So we have Q, M, C, and delta T. So delta T, let's start with that. That's going to be the change in temperature. M is going to be mass, and that's usually going to be in kilograms. Q is going to be the amount of energy. And we're going to measure that in joules. So that is actually heat. Because remember, this is going to involve a transfer of thermal energy. That is what heat is. So when heat moves from one object to another or from one place to another, that is what we're talking about. So it's the heat that is transferred. Now C is kind of special, and that is the capacity for specific heat. And every substance in the universe has its own special number. This is kind of like your student number. It's kind of like a grown-up social security number. It's a number that's special for that substance. But it is defined as the amount of energy needed to raise 1 kilogram of matter 1 degree Celsius. All right. So for, let's say, water. Water's specific heat capacity is going to be 4,184 joules per kilogram times degrees Celsius. So you got to have the energy unit there, the mass unit, and the temperature unit all together when you illustrate specific heat capacity and the Q equals MC delta T formula. Something that might be prudent to state right now is that anytime you see a delta in an equation, that represents change or the alteration that takes place. All right. Now, that can also be a negative number. If you have, let's say, a can of soda, when you first buy it from the store, it's room temperature. And you might be thinking, well, I don't want to drink that, so I'll put it in the fridge, let it cool down for a while. Well, as it's in the refrigerator, it's actually losing energy. So in that situation, Q is going to be a negative number because you're taking energy out of it to make it colder. So, you know, your delta T can definitely be a negative number. Q can be negative, but M and C will never be negative. You cannot have negative mass, and you just can't have a negative for C either. But delta T can be negative, and Q can also be negative. So here are some, just samples of capacities for different substances. We have air, aluminum, copper, ethanol, glass, ice, mercury, steel, and water. And what you're going to notice here with this list is we know that metals are great conductors of heat. So when you look at this chart, things that are metal are going to have a much lower number because it's easier for them to transfer that energy. All right, so moving right along, looking at temperature, we have some different diagrams that we use for that, but the one that I feel is most important is the phase diagrams that we see that show the different types of states that these substances can be in. So first we have the solid state, the liquid state, and the vapor state. Now vapor is going to be the largest portion of this chart. Here we have the triple point. Triple point is the pressure and temperature at which all three states can coexist. So if this precise place